Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Amen. Go ahead and open your Bibles and see if you're in the Spirit or not. To Philippians chapter 4. You know, pastors are interesting creatures. You know, things affect us. And I don't mean in a bad way, but, you know, I had a conversation recently about some things, and I got some scriptures came out while I was having that conversation, and this sermon came out of that. So, you know, those things happen. Hallelujah. So let's go ahead, and we're going to talk about this morning the effects of the human condition and really how to break it. You know, the human condition is, you know, we're born into the world. You know, when you're born into the world, you're born into a broken world. How many figured that out? Anybody hadn't figured that out? Good. We don't have to do any special prayer then. We're born into a broken world. Now, you might have been born into a rich family. It's still broken. Amen. You might have been born into a poor family. It's still broken. You know, well, man, if I was just born with a lot of money. Listen, you know, anybody ever studied the Kennedys? Yeah. They were born ever since, you know, from the back of the 20s, when they got all that money and it got all put into a trust. Those folks have had a rough way to go. So just because you're born with money don't mean it's going to be everything's going to be all right. Well, I would just be, you can have all the money in the world and just be a drunk, heroin, cocaine, meth, designer drug addict, have no joy in your life, can't find any joy. Now, the human condition is broken. The human condition is a broken condition that needs a fix. Now, number one, you can't fix anything until you get Jesus. If you're outside of the kingdom of God, if you are not born again, if Jesus is not your Lord, then you're not going to get the soul fixed, you're not going to get your body fixed, you're not going to get your money fixed. None of that's going to get right until you get Jesus. You got to be born again. Amen. The void in the heart of man. Man has been alienated and separated from God because of the fall of Adam. Adam, you know, I get tickled sometimes listening to these people say, well, we're just having a nudist colony. We're just acting like Adam and Eve in the garden. Not! Adam and Eve were clothed in the glory of God, and it wasn't until they sinned and their spirits became joined to Satan, as one person said, Adam was the first man to be born again. He was born from life unto death. Satan became his spiritual father. How do you know that? Jesus said in John, I believe 8:44, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will fulfill. Adam was alive unto God at creation. He was a man who had the image and likeness of God. And 1 John repeatedly says, God is light. Adam was a light being. Yoda had it right. Luminous beings we are. No, I'm sorry. Hallelujah. You know, all cults and all religions of the world have some element of truth in them. You'll find some element because all creation came out of what God did. And so there's been perversions and manipulations of it, but there's always going to be an element you'll find in there of truth. You know, we were created as light beings. And if you want to kind of get an idea of it, when Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration, you know, Peter, James, and John fell asleep. They were kind of snoozing, and all of a sudden they wake up, and there's Jesus glowing. What was that? He let out what Adam looked like in the beginning of creation. He was glowing so bright, it changed his raiment. Moses went up into the mount and got in the presence of God, and his face was radiating the reflection of the glory of God so much, they had to put a veil over it. Now, think of a being created without sin, without, you know, any degradation in the beginning, that when God put his spirit in Adam, what was it? God's spirit's light. It radiated. Adam was clothed in the glory of God. He was not naked in the sense that, you know, he didn't have clothes on that we know about. He had the glory on. Hello. Now, when they ate the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, and the light went out, then they knew they were naked. Why? The light went out. They became separated from God. The glory went out. And that's when then they started having wrinkles. So forget them nudists calling the people, they're crazy. I said, they're just crazy. Hallelujah. You won't be like Adam and Eve in the garden. Yeah, right. Anyway. But man was created to be like God. And then in the fall, man came into a condition that was broken. He had a broken relationship with God. He was separated from God. He was alienated from the life of God. God's life was no longer in him. And then through beginning with a series of covenant, the Adamic covenant, God cut a covenant to Adam there in the garden, and killed animals to cover his sin, clothed them with skins. You know, it was a covering. It wasn't a redemption. It was simply an atonement. And then we go on through that. And then we get the Mosaic law and the all the Levitical ordinances and so forth. But those were all covenants and numerous covenants throughout all the Old Testament, the Adamic, the Abrahamic, the Mosaic. You know, all those things were done in order to bring us to the new covenant. See, and they were all there, and on all we could get out of them was atonement, a covering, you know, a putting off every year, pushing it back, until the one who could come. Oh God, I'm so glad he came. Amen. You know, Hebrews chapter 9 says, "For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the sprinkling of the ashes of a heifer sanctify to the purifying of the flesh." I like the next words. How much more? How much more? How much more shall the blood of Christ? Woo, glory. I mean, right there, that's shouting grounds right there. I mean, you get your little dance going on right there over that. Amen? How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience? Ooh, glory. From dead works to serve the living God. Under the old covenant, the Bible says they had a remembrance year after year of what they had done. But when Jesus comes, he comes to cleanse your conscience. Amen? He comes to fix the human condition. The human condition of separation and alienation from God. Amen. Now, we have preached in the church over the years, man, if you just get saved, everything's going to be all right. That is the first step. That gets the spirit of man back in proper relationship with the Father, joined back unto the Father. But there are still human conditions you got to deal with, like your head. Amen? And your body. Now, come on now. I'm telling you, your head and your body will just fight you, I mean, every step. Your spirit, because you first get born again, you're a babe. Peter says, desire to sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. You got to grow. We got to train. You need good churches. You need good pastors. You need to be under the word of God. Why? Because you got to grow. You're not going to get saved and everything. Woo, praise God. I'm never going to have another trouble the rest of the day of my life. Boy, I'm going to tell you what, in about 2 weeks, the devil's going to put your feet where your head was 2 seconds before. If you think, and see, we've preached this, come to Jesus and everything's going to be all right. You're going to get on the right path. You're going to be born again. Your estate in heaven becomes settled. Like Brother Hagin says, you're not ready to live until you're ready to die. When you get born again, you're ready to die. Well, I mean, because you get to go, you know, Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. But you know what? There's still stuff you got to deal with. How many found that out? And you've been born again a week, and man, you all of a sudden your thing's going great, and all of a sudden you do something, you go, oh, Jesus, I'm not even saved. I'm not even saved. I remember when I first got saved, I was playing, old baseball players go to church league softball. Anyway, I went to church league softball. There was nowhere to go. I got recruited. They wanted me to play ball. I was a good baseball player in high school. I enjoyed playing baseball, and so you go play softball. Oh, well, you know, there's no semi-pro teams, there's no college, you can get picked up by college. If you don't get picked up by college, you go play softball, all right? So we're having a ball game, and we have a horrible inning. I mean, you know, we're like the number one team in the league, and we have a horrible inning, we give up 10 runs in one inning. And I come in from the field, and just like in the old days, a week and 10 days earlier, I come in, I threw my gloves, and said, what in the blank is wrong with you? Yeah. Just got saved. I'm on the end of the bed. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God. I don't know if I got saved or not. I grew up Pentecostal. I was going to hell. You understand Pentecostals are Armenian. Okay? You got those extremes. Calvinism and Armenianism. Okay? Calvinism, man, you get saved and baby, you are locked in. No matter what. Armenianism. You cuss come off the baseball field and Jesus comes back, you are burning, baby. You are toast. If you don't know it or not, Dake's analytical Bible, he was Arminius. He has a thing, 19 reasons a man can be born again and again. No, you can't! Hello. Yeah. But I mean, Pentecostals, we believe, man, I'm telling you, if we're sitting right here and I walk up to Cap and just kind of go, what? And he gets mad and says, you know, cusses me or something, and Jesus, the rapture took place. He is going to hell. See you, buddy. Sorry. I'm preaching. All right. So anyway, you know, we get these ideas, we get these extremes, we get these crazy ideas. You know, man, if you just get saved, everything's going to be all right, and you found out it won't all right. Your head was giving you a fit. Your flesh was giving you a fit. And, you know, and we just, oh, just thank God that you got saved. Well, I'm glad I got saved, but I got to do something about all this other stuff. Amen. Why? Because it displeases God. Amen. I said it displeases God. And we've got to deal with these things. And see, in the Bible, if we'll study it, tells us how to deal with these things. Amen. Romans chapter 12 tells you what to do with that body. Now, do not go to the Philippines and get up on a cross and nail yourself to it and crucify yourself. That don't work. Okay, they do that every Easter over there. You know, and it's just a cult. They actually crucify themselves to suffer like Jesus. Well, that ain't going to get you anything but holes in your wrist and in your feet and probably dead. Okay, that don't fix it. Paul said to the church at Rome, he said, present your bodies a living sacrifice, which is your reasonable, King James, spiritual service, better translated. Your spiritual service with your body is to keep it in a sacrificial state. What's that mean? You got to tell it no a bunch. You might have to wake up and say no. Some of you had to tell it no this morning. To what? I'm going to roll over and go back to sleep and show up at 12:30 for the food. Some of you, I say, no, I'm getting out of bed. You got to tell body, no, you can't have those drugs. No, you can't go out and run around with them women. Or men. Yeah, but God knows I have needs. God said no. You got to tell your body, you've got to offer your body. It is a spiritual service to keep your body in check. Okay, so we have to deal with our body. And then, but the one thing we need to deal with more than anything else is your mind. Amen. That is the battleground where Satan will defeat you or you will defeat him. Doing 500, help me, Jesus, will not fix it. You can do it all day long, it's not going to fix it. Come on now. No, you're going to have to learn to deal with and work on these arenas. Now let's go to Philippians 4 like you're supposed to be. And I'm not. How many got there? How many know where I'm going? Philippians 4, starting in verse 10. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the end your care of me hath flourished again, wherein you also were careful, but you lacked opportunity. Now Paul's writing to the church at Philippi and telling them that they're taking care of him financially, people. They had gotten to a place they couldn't, but then they had reversed again. They were now taking care of him again. He says, for not that I speak in respect of want. Now, he's saying, basically, I'm saying, I'm not trying to manipulate you. For I have learned that whatever state I'm in, or whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Now, with a lot of traditional teachers, we look at that word content, and we kind of read put up with. Kind of hang out there. Okay, we're going to live there. I just got to be content with this and with that. Paul said, whatever state I am, there with to be content. 20th century New Testament says, do not think I am saying this under the pressure of want. For I, however I am placed. You could have been born poor. You could have been born rich. You could have been born in a drug addict family. You could have been born in all kinds of conditions of life. Paul said, I have learned however I am placed. Therein, however I am placed, I have learned to be independent of the circumstances. I have learned to be independent of the circumstances. It goes on to the next verse in the King James and says this, I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry and both to abound and to suffer need. I read one commentary one time that says this. He said, I know how to be abased, not lose my poise. I know how to abound and not lose my head. However I am initiated in life, I've learned these things. And then he goes on the next verse and says this, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Oh, glory to God. Thank God. You know, you may be suffering through difficult circumstances financially, emotionally, physically. I mean, we could come up with a gamut of things people go through. And if I just had enough money, I'm going to tell you something. You know, Creflo said something one time that I've always kind of gone, that's really good. He said, money is a magnifier. What's that mean? If you're a small street junkie and you win get $1 million at the lottery, you just become a designer junkie. The money doesn't fit, it just magnifies what's already there. If you're running around with some ratchet on the slide, are you here? When you get $1 million, you just go get you a high class ratchet. Come on now, we got to tell it like it is though. We can't be pulling no punches. You know, all that money does is magnifies what's in you. So don't think money's your fixer. Money is not your fixer, folks. Winning the lottery is not going to fix it. But about 15 years ago, we had Van Croucher here. We had him a number of times, and me and Van are out at dinner after service. And he says, you know, now there's been some things that have changed some of this since then. Michael Jordan, some of these guys put together mentoring programs for these little guys. But you take some kid who's lived all of his life poor, lived all of his life in the projects. He gets a $15 million contract to go play pro basketball. And then in 7 or 8 years, his injuries happen or something happens, and he has to retire, and they retired broke. $15 million a year, 7, 8, 9, 10 years, and retired broke. What did they do? They just elevated their lifestyle to match the income. The money didn't fix the problem. I said, the money didn't fix the problem. What Paul learned fixes the problem. Now, I kind of always got to sit back and go, why in the world do people who don't have enough money find the money to go buy some Mad Dog 2020 or some Richard's Wild Irish Rose wine? Come on now, go get you some Canadian, get some cheap drunks going on. But they find money to get drunk, they find money to get pot, they find money to get drugs, thinking that, you know, if they can just escape this, they're going to be all right. Let me tell you something, those things are not going to fix the human condition. Paul said, I have learned that whatever state I am in, to be independent of the circumstances. What was Paul talking about? Let's run back over from there to 2 Corinthians chapter. We'll start in 11. Now let's go for 12. We'll go 12. We'll go 12. We're back into 11. How about that? 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I think one of the most misunderstood passages in certain things in the church. We'll start here in verse 7. Lest I should be exalted above the measure through the abundance of revelations, there was given unto me a thorn in the flesh. Everybody say, the messenger. Anybody know what the word messenger is in the Greek? Angelos. You know what that is? Angel. There was given an angel. There was a spirit being that came and attacked Paul. All right? There was given to me the messenger of Satan, an angel, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above the measures. For this thing I besought the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said, Paul, just put up with it. You're just going to deal with it, dude. I'm gracing you to deal with it, just to put up with it. Well, see, when we don't rightly interpret the word grace and what it means, particularly in context, we come up with crazy stuff in the church. Now, I grew up in Pentecostals. We'll stand in front of, I believe in divine healing as in the atonement. And then you turn around and you got one woman who's suffering like Job, got Paul's thorn, and like the man born blind embodied in her. And you're sitting there, you're like the pinball machine. Really? Yeah, I'm like the man born blind, suffering like Job, and Paul's thorn. You know, really? Yep. How do you help somebody like that? Well, if they won't listen to you, you can't help them. Jesus said, "See, Paul went to the Lord three. Lord, I'm tired of dealing with this stuff. And if you're dealing with it in the flesh, and you're dealing with it with human effort and human ability, you're going to get wearied." As long as you turn to your ability to see you through, you are going to be defeated. There is only one way to get victory, and that is tap into the higher power. Tap into the Lord himself. Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. What are you going to say there? For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Now, the word strength there is dunamis. As a matter of fact, later in this verse, he uses the word power, and it's also dunamis. Miraculous power, supernatural power, power that comes from God, okay? We get our English word dynamite from it. That's where it comes from, the Greek dunamis. Jesus said, so what is Jesus' grace here? It's miraculous power. My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength, my dunamis. See, Jesus defined the word grace for this passage. I know our general definition is God's unmerited, undeserved favor. But really that word carries a deeper, it's giftings, it's gifts. Well, the gift here is strength. Grace is not limited to one definition. And I'm going to be honest with you, if you take undeserved, unmerited favor and put it everywhere grace is, nothing will make sense in a lot of places. You'll read it and go, that don't make any sense. Why? Because it means more than that. The parameters of it have to be changed for the context. Okay? He says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, my weaknesses, my inabilities. That the power, the dunamis of Christ may rest upon me. What did Paul say? He said, man, I got beat up. I got buffeted. I got knocked around. You got to remember this is in context of chapter 11. We'll go back and read that in just a second. And finally he goes, Lord, I've had enough. Anybody ever got there where he said, you want to say, Lord, I've had enough. I can't take anymore. And Jesus didn't say, poor Paul. Oh, buddy, I'm so sorry. Life's been hard. I'm not making fun, but you know, we've got to change the way we approach things. The Lord said, Paul, my grace is more than enough because my dunamis is perfected in your weakness. Now, God doesn't send power just so you can look at it. Are you here? We have lights in our homes. We don't have lights so we can just sit there, oh, isn't that light nice? We have lights so we can use them to do things. They're a tool for us to be able to function. God's power comes into our lives. There is a tool for us to be able to function and do things. He said, my miracle power, glory to God, is perfected, what? When you've reached your inability. Paul said, whoa! Paul didn't go, oh, man, that's not what I wanted to hear. He said, I'm going to rejoice when the reproaches come. I'm going to rejoice when the weaknesses come. I'm going to rejoice when the infirmities come. Why? Because his power, oh, thank God for the power. His power is going to rest on me. And it is not just the power to stand there and get your teeth knocked out. It's the power to victory. Let's back up here, chapter. Let's read you the context in which chapter 12 shows up. Now, two groups of people Paul had to deal with on a continual basis were Judaizers and Gnostics. Okay? The Gnostics were the ones who believed that all matter was evil and only spirit was good. So basically, it did not matter what you did with matter. Okay? I was just trying to be funny there. Thank you. Thank you for the one courtesy laugh there on the front row. It didn't matter what you did with your body. It was evil anyway. Spirits, they didn't even believe Jesus came in the flesh. Didn't believe he died on the cross. Didn't believe he was raised from the dead. Now, 1 John starts out, the word of life, which we've touched, which we've handled, which we've seen. In other words, Gnostics, he was real. The other people Paul had to deal with were the Judaizers. The Judaizers were the bunch that would show up and say, well, yeah, you've received Jesus, but you got to do this law, and you got to do that law, and you got to live under this law. And as a matter of fact, you Gentiles, you got to be circumcised because you did get circumcised, and you got to be circumcised to be under the covenant. Now, Paul got pretty crude with them over in the book of Galatians. He said, you know, if you're going to circumcise, now, I know it's crude, but this is what he said. This is what he says. King James dresses it real nice. He said, if you're going to circumcise, you may as well go all the way and cut everything off. That's what the Greek says. And he didn't like Judaizers. Because if circumcision will save you, man, you can get really saved. Okay? And that's what he said. I mean, you know, King James doesn't say it that way. It's really dressed up, but that is what it says. So he didn't like Judaizers, he didn't like Gnostics. Why? They took away from the work of Jesus. Jesus came in the flesh. Jesus died in the flesh. Jesus became sin for us who knew no sin. Jesus was raised from the dead, picked up his body, it was a glorified body, ascended to the right hand of the Father, and sat down to the right hand of the Father, wherever he lives, to make intercession for us. The Judaizers are always coming in, trying to make us, can't eat pork. we got a bunch of pig over there, P-O-R-K, pork, and we're going to indulge as soon as this service is over. Hallelujah, because I've been liberated from Judaizers. Hallelujah. But Paul would deal with Judaism, and here's what he's dealing with in chapter 11. He's dealing with the people who tried to come with their credentials. I am apostle bishop of the first order of the apostolic, evangelistic, Zionist realm. Yeah, I see some people with their cards, and I'm like, my God, what in the world are you talking about? You know? That's right, it's an index card. No, it's on a flash drive. Their title's on a flash drive. You know? Well, they were coming to the churches and saying, listen, Paul's off here. You know, and they tried to share their credentials. So Paul comes up here in chapter 11, verse 1, and says this, would to God you would bear me a little in my folly, and indeed bear me, for I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy, and I have espoused you to one husband, that I might present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear, lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Paul brought a simple message. Some people come along and try to make it so complicated. They make it so complicated. I mean, we had back in the 70s, we had the shepherding movement. Some of y'all might remember the shepherding movement. You had your own personal shepherd, and he was an elder in the church, and you had to go ask him, can I go on vacation? Can I marry this woman? Can I change jobs? First time somebody comes to me and tells me, you got to answer to me to get, you know, be able to change your jobs, I might smack you and then ask for forgiveness. For he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom you've not preached, whom we've not preached, and if you receive another spirit, which you have not received, or another gospel, which you have not accepted, you might all well bear with him. For I suppose I was not with behind, or the least behind, the very chiefest apostles. And Paul's saying, listen, I wasn't one of the guys who's a big dog. I wasn't Peter. I wasn't James. I wasn't the guys in Jerusalem. I wasn't one of them. He said, but I didn't come far behind them. But though I might be rude in speech, now you say Paul was crude. Well, that's why I just gave you one of his crude examples. Well, sometimes you gotta get through to people so they understand. Hello? You gotta smack them. Like right upside the head with the word. So they wake up. Well, oh my God. All right. But though I be rude in speech, yet not in knowledge. I'm not rude in knowledge. But we have been have thoroughly made manifest among you in all things. Have I committed an offense in abasing myself that ye might be exalted? Because I have preached to you the gospel of God freely. I robbed other churches, taking wages of them to do you service. I'm trying to minister you, Corinthians. I wouldn't even take money from you guys because you guys were running your mouth. All I have, want you, honey. You know, get away from, run from people like that. What does Pastor Ed do with all that money? Slap him and run. They're out to get you away from your the anointing. And when I was present with you and wanted, I was chargeable to no man for that which was lacking to me, brethren which came from Macedonia. In other words, I was in a place with you and I didn't have enough money to do things. I needed things. And people came. You didn't even take care of me. I was chargeable to no man for that which was lacking to me, the brethren which came from Macedonia supplied. And in all things, I have kept myself from being burdensome unto you. And so I will keep myself. As the truth is of Christ is in me, no man shall stop me from this boasting in the region of Achaia. Wherefore, because I love you, not, no, God knoweth, I may cut off, but I do what I will do, that I may cut off occasion from them which would desire occasion, and wherewith they glory, that they may be found even as we are. Now, what Paul's saying here is, he's arguing the case, I wouldn't normally do this, but some people have been coming in, and you've been listening to them, so I'm going to defend my position. And you have nothing to say about me because I wouldn't even take money from you. Other churches sent money so I could take care of you. You could almost hear him saying, bozos, hard heads. Are you here? For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great things if his ministers also transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. I'm going to stop right here. There's too much of this, don't judge, only love, never judge, going on in the church when ministers are standing up who know the truth and are sharing the truth to protect the flock. And people go, that's not the love of God. There are false ministers. There are false apostles. They've been sent by Satan to deceive the church. And the true apostles and the true pastors and the true ministers have a responsibility to guard and protect the flock. And it is not judgmental to point out error. It is not judgmental to point out what is wrong. You shouldn't judge. I'm not judging. I'm just saying what the Bible says about it. Let the word judge it. Hello? I say again, let no man think me a fool, if otherwise, yet as a fool receive me, that I may boast myself a little. That which I speak it after the Lord, but as it were foolish, not after the Lord, but as it were foolishly, in the confidence of this boasting. Seeing that many glory after the flesh, I will glory also. In other words, they try to talk about how great their credentials are. For ye yourselves, you suffer fools gladly, seeing yourselves are wise. It amazes me how people can listen to some of the dumbest stuff that people listen to, and you come back and say, well, the Bible says this. Yeah, but they were so anointed. How can they be anointed when it doesn't line up with the Bible? My God. It doesn't line up with the Word. Everybody's going to heaven. Really? That's universalism. One of the biggest churches in America back in the 70s and 80s in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the pastor was Carmen. It's Carmen, if y'all know who Carmen is. He was his pastor. That's the church he went to. Man could preach. But he went off to some meeting somewhere. A devil got on him. He came back to his church and started preaching universalism. And in less than 2 years, his church went from 5,000 to less than 200. And in the third year, they had to close the doors. Now, Oral Roberts, Lester Summerall, and I forgot who else, went to him to talk to him about his doctrine. He was in error, and he wouldn't listen. Lost his church. 5,000 to nothing. Got on ABC and said, I know I'm preaching a lot of stuff that ain't in that book, but I know I'm right. Yeah. That's why we had to preach truth. Amen? For you suffer if a man bring you into bondage, if a man devour you, if a man take of you, if a man exalt himself, if a man smite you in the face. I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, wheresoever any is bold, I speak foolishly. I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? Well, so am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. In other words, they're not really. I am more. Listen to what Paul says. In labors, more abundant. In stripes, above measures. In prisons, more frequent. In deaths, often. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. In case you can't figure it out with the new Common Core math, that's 39. Hallelujah. Thrice I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. When was he stoned? Remember, he was stoned and left for dead. Now, most scholars believe that when Paul was stoned and left for dead, that is when he knew a man about 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body, such a one was called up into the third heaven and heard things unlawful to be uttered. What things was it that he was unlawful to be uttered? All the things it took him the rest of his life to write out in his letters. He had the revelation of what it means to be in Christ. Thank God we're in Christ. Amen? Hallelujah. Then he goes on. Night and day I've been in the deep, journeyings often, in perils often, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own country. That's the worst kind of perils of your own countrymen. In perils of the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, and watchings often, and hunger and thirst, and fastings often, and cold and nakedness. Anybody getting tired just listening to it? That's all stuff. Then besides all this, that which cometh upon that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of the churches. Who's weak? I'm not weak. Who's offended? And I burn not. If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern mine infirmities, that the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is blessed forevermore, knoweth that I lie not. Then Damascus, the governor kept me under Artemas. The king kept the city of Damascus with a garrison, desirous to apprehend me. And through a window in a basket, I was let down by the wall and escaped his hands. Now, this is the foundation upon which Paul goes into and talks about the thorn in the flesh. He was out doing the work of God, doing what he knew to do, living the best he knew how to live, trying to do the things that God wanted him to do. And he's getting beat, he's getting kicked, he's getting spit on, he's getting stoned. I mean, he's getting tried to get arrested. I mean, they're beating him. They're with rods, they're beating him with whips. I mean, all kind. I mean, his own. Listen, it's bad enough when the heathen and the robbers and all the people that don't like you are after you. It's when the people that are supposed to love you get after you. He said his own countrymen were after him. And Paul, he gets over here, and he gets out here in the chapter 12 and finally goes, Lord, I've had enough. And we've all probably been in our prayer closet and said, Lord, I've had enough. Yeah. Yeah. And Jesus comes to him. 3 times he did it. Apparently, he didn't think the Lord heard him the first time. Let me say something. Asking the Lord three times ain't going to fix it. Hello? I mean, it's in Tony Orlando and Don, not three times. Oh, yeah, sorry, wrong song. Paul asked, and Jesus comes and said, my grace is sufficient for you. Now listen, understand Jesus is not coming to Paul and telling him, this is your life. You're just going to have to figure out how to deal with it. It may be what Paul was going to put up with, but you know, he said, my grace is sufficient. My grace is the enabler. But what about this grace? What grace is he talking about? We talked about it earlier. Now he comes and says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength, my dunamis will be perfected in your weakness. Paul said, I'm going to rejoice because when I'm weak, then am I strong. He said, I'm rejoicing in all these infirmities. I'm rejoicing in all these things that the power, the dunamis, may rest on me. That's what brings me back to Philippians chapter 4. Because Paul said, in whatever state I am initiated, I have learned to be independent of the circumstances. I have learned that I can be in abased circumstances. I cannot have enough. I can be hungry. I can be in the deep, and I can be in perils, and I can be beat, and all this stuff's going on. But I've learned, why? Because the grace of God rests on me. His strength comes on me. I can be independent of that and still stand strong and still stand victorious. I've learned that I can come over here, have too much, more money than I know what to do with, and I'm not going to lose my head and become some kind of crazy druggie or whatever. Listen, I know people all the time talking about, man, if I'm believing God to be able to get to, you know, where I give 90% to the church, and they go, I'm going to win the lottery, I'm going to get $200 million, and I'm going to tithe, and you won't see them again. Amen. There's a man in West Virginia a number of years ago, about 15 years ago, won the lottery, $60 or $70 million, I forgot how much he won, and that man went crazy. One of his grandchildren tried to kill him to get the money. He would go into strip clubs with $500,000 in a briefcase. Now, you know what he said the day he won the lottery? I'm going to tithe to my church. He lost his head. I said he lost his head. When you come to the place that you realize that your sustenance, that your steadfastness, the journey you're on comes from looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Remember the Old Testament guys over there in Hebrews chapter 11? It says, you know, some of them, you know, refuse their deliverance, being sawn asunder. You know, it goes on, lists a bunch of different stuff. And it finally says this, that they came to a place that they, without us, could not be made perfect. They refused to accept that they, without us, would not be made perfect. And then Paul, I believe Paul wrote Hebrews, goes into chapter 12 and says, wherefore, seeing we are compassed about by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin that does so easily beset us. See, sin will beset you, but so will weights. And if your mind is always grappling over here in the not enough or over in the too much, in other words, if your mind is always dealing with the circumstances of life, it's a weight. And it'll hold you down and it'll hold you back. And what the Word of God says, it says, lay aside the weight and the sin because they easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. What did Paul say? I've learned to be independent of the circumstances. How do you become independent of the circumstances? You get your eyes on the one who's already run the race for you. You get your eyes on the one who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the shame of the cross. And, amen. And won that battle and then sat down at the right hand of the Father. Glory to God. He is the author and the finisher of your faith. Praise God. Amen. And I want you to know today. I do not know what your state is. I don't know if you've got too much. I don't know if you don't have enough. I don't know if, you know, if you're dealing with, you know, emotional pains. I don't know if you're dealing with physical pains. I don't know if you're dealing with financial issues. I don't know all you, but he does. And the answer for all of you is still the same. You look to Jesus, and you become independent of the circumstances. Paul said, I have learned that whatever state I'm initiated in, however I'm initiated in life, these circumstances do not govern me. Hallelujah. A lot of times we're looking for the, you know, why am I going through this? I got a word for you. Devil! There's a mean devil out there. He hates God's creation. He's come to kill, steal, and destroy. John 10:10, Jesus said, the thief cometh not but for to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And then he gives the antithesis to that. I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Yeah, but we're in a fallen world. Stuff's going, yep, that devil's out there. I said, that devil's out there. And he's a coming. And he's a looking. Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus and said, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand in the evil day. What's he saying? There's a day coming that Satan is going to come out and attack you. Don't stand there and go, why did this happen to me? Don't sing hee-haw songs. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. How many ever saw hee-haw? How many have never seen hee-haw? Raise your hand. You've never seen hee-haw. You've missed half your life. All right. Had the other song, where are you tonight? Why did you leave me here all alone? Search the world over, thought I found true love. You met another and you was gone. We cannot allow our souls to embellish the places of defeat when Paul said, I have learned to be independent from those places. We have to come to a place that regardless of the circumstances of life, we have victory. Now, Paul wrote to the church in 2 Corinthians in chapter 4. Look over there with me real quick. We're going to finish up here. How many give me 5 more minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Okay, thank you. That's enough. That's all I need. Thank y'all. Used to, everybody raise your hand, you get 60, 70 minutes or something, but now they don't do it anymore. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Well, let's start back up here in it's a good chapter. I want to read the whole thing. We're not going to do it. Verse 7. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. Everybody touch yourself somewhere on your shoulder or whatever. Say, that's an earthen vessel. You've got a treasure in it. Man, you need to stop looking and going, well, I don't have a way out. I don't know what to do. And realize there's a treasure in you. Glory to God. We have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellency of the power of maybe of God, not of us. This is what it says. We're troubled on every side, but not distressed. And this is Paul saying the same thing. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in us. For we do always live. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. We have in the same spirit of faith. According as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. That's how faith works. You believe it and you say it. I said, you believe, but see, the spirit of faith speaks what? What the word says. Remember, Romans 10 says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You don't get faith from defeat. You get faith out of God's word. And God's word will speak contrary to what you're dealing with. That's why Paul said, I could be persecuted. And you know, one place in the Bible, he said, I've been knocked down, but not knocked out. Hallelujah. I said, knocked down, but not knocked out. Thank God we don't have to get knocked out. Yeah, you might get knocked by what's going on in life. You just get back up and say, woo, glory to God. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Hallelujah. Amen. Knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by the Lord and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not. Here we go. Don't faint. You may be going through some of the toughest things you can imagine, emotionally, mentally, whatever, financially, whatever it is. You may be going, I have been drained. But for which cause we faint not. Though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For listen to what Paul says. Now, you remember what Paul wrote over there? Actually, later on in the same chapter, same book, he writes all that stuff he went through. He says, I light affliction. Why is it a light affliction? You have to compare the affliction to the power and the glory of God that can get you out of it. Amen. For our light affliction is but for a moment, working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things which are seen. Dear God, what do you say? Pastor, I have to pluck my eyeballs out. No, you got to stop looking at the things which you can see. Now, the word seen here is not representative of just the eyeballs. It's talking about your senses. While we are not governed by our senses, what we can see, what we can hear, what we can smell, what we can taste, what we can touch. That is the import of what he's saying. Not just looking at things which you can see. He's talking about what your senses tell you. Your senses can tell you a lot. Your senses can say, I feel pain, I'm going to die. Jesus! I hurt, I would die. You feel that. Paul said, I'm not letting that govern me. I'm not going to let that control me. You might go home, look at your checkbook and say, Jesus, I'm going broke. Oh, God, have you seen my bills? He knew about them before you made them. Hello? You don't know what they said about me. My house is on fire. There's a diesel tow truck out there pulling my car if I steal it. Paul said, I'm not going to let my senses govern me. I'm not governed by these things. I'm not talking about being stupid. You don't write checks with no money in the bank. That's not a faith check. That's a bouncing check. Okay? I've seen people write what they call faith checks. Yep, praise God. I believe God's money's going to be in the bank in the morning. And then I come back to see you next week. You wrote a bad check to the church. He said, for this cause we faint not, but though the outward man perish, the inward man is renewed day by day, for our light afflictions, but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding great and weighty glory. Hallelujah. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. This word temporal means, in a kind of a slang way, subject to change. It's subject to change. What we look at or are governed by the things which are not seen, which are eternal. I know one thing the Bible says is eternal. Thy word, O Lord, is forever settled in heaven. The doctor can say, you're going to die. But 1 Peter 2:24 says, by his stripes I was healed. The bank says, we're going to repossess your house. But God says, he meets my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Amen. You might feel like everybody's out to get me. Many are they that rise up against me. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, the glory and the lifter of my head. Hallelujah. Paul began to understand that when we live according to the word of God, that whatever's going on over here, or maybe 1,000 fall at my one hand and 10,000 at my other hand, but it won't come nigh me. Hallelujah. I said, hallelujah. Remember the anthrax scare was going on all over the place? People were sending anthrax in the mail. Did you know that in Psalm 91, where it says that we're not going to be afraid of the noisome pestilence, that means animal diseases? Anthrax is an animal disease. We had a Bible verse for anthrax before it ever got invented. God knows what God knows. So we just started quoting, I'm not afraid of noisome pestilence. Ain't no anthrax going to get me, baby. Why? Jesus! Hallelujah. See, I already have an answer. The Bible says he knows what you have need of before you ask or to even think about it. He had the solution to... Oh, y'all got it fixed. Woo! Upgraded to Windows 10. We had a mess. Anyway. But we got the stuff we had. We thought we had it fixed, but that's why you didn't see the words this morning during the music. But they got it going. Go, way to go, Belinda. Let me read you a few verses. Y'all gave me five. I only used five of the 25 I got. 2 Corinthians 2:14. Now, folks, you might have good friends that tell you stuff. You might like the way your preacher preaches. But I am going to tell you something. You need to find out what the Bible says about stuff. Because what the Word says, your head might tell you something. Listen, I've talked to people and they'll say, yeah, but I just believe. But the Bible says, yeah, I know that, but I believe. No. Smack! You just want to smack them. Because you think you might fix you. Maybe you knock some sense into their stupid head. My brother, I think, Dad, hey, you say, bless their darling hearts and stupid heads. I call it SOS, stupid on steroids. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, thanks be to God. Everybody say, thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, thanks be to God. Say, thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
What for?
Which always
causes us to triumph in Christ and makes manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. Here's something interesting. The word here where it says, now thanks be to God, which causes us to triumph. That phrase in the Greek says it this way, which leads us in a continual triumphal procession. He's always leading us in a triumphal procession. Might be saying the word wrong, but anyway, you got it. We're walking in a triumph. Listen, not just a one-time event. It's a continual triumphal procession. Some of y'all remember when you graduated from high school, graduated from college, you got to march out, you know, after you threw your hat and found it and put it back on, you got to turn your tassel and all that stuff. And then you marched out, graduate! But you see, Jesus is leading us consistently in the realm of victory. There's a procession, it's a continual triumphal procession that we walk in. God, he always causes us. I like that. I don't have verses to say he always causes us to be defeated. He's always putting stuff on you. You can't figure out why it's on you, and you might learn one day, but if you don't, you're just going to have to learn to put up with it. Paul said, I went to the Lord about it, and he said, my grace is enough. Paul said, man, I can get the power of God. When the devil comes in and does everything he's going to do to me and brings me to the point I don't have anything left, whoa! I'm going to start rejoicing. Why? Because here comes the power. Right in that spot comes the power. I've done everything I'm supposed to do. I've done everything I know to do. And he smacked me again. Whoa! Go ahead, hit me again. Hit me one more time. Come on. Just pull up a deal. Hit me one more time. You're not going to pull out your little Glock or whatever. Go ahead. Woo! Thank you, devil. I'm at my weakest. I rejoice! Because here comes the power. They put me over the top. And whatever I couldn't figure out, whatever I couldn't do to make it happen, the power of God comes on me. And now Jesus is leading me in a continual triumphant procession. Hallelujah. I'm always triumphing in him. Glory to God. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Just a little bit back from where we are. In verse 57, let's back up. Verse 55, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Now think about this. We live our whole life afraid of dying and afraid of all these things. And Paul said, he got to the place, remember, he's independent of the circumstances. He just said, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Amen. The sting of death is sin, the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be unto God, or thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Then he says, you get the victory through Jesus, and then he says in verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, are you here? Are you ready for this? Be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. But what, therefore, somebody said one time, if you see the word therefore, check out what it's there for. And it's therefore because the previous verse said, thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, praise God. Your human condition may have initiated you in one place that I'm not in. May initiate somebody else in a place that, listen, life is out there. Stuff's going on. The devil's mean. The devil don't like you, in case you're wondering. You're representative of the very thing he hates the most. But don't be afraid. Don't be downcast. Don't get weary. Don't give up and don't throw in the towel. Just lift up your hands, hallelujah, and begin to rejoice and give glory be to God, hallelujah, amen, hallelujah, and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you. Now that I'm at the end of me, now you take over. Your power comes on the scene. And devil, you in a heap of trouble, boy. Because you're about to come in contact with the law of the Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus. And it makes me free from the law of sin and death. Hallelujah. John G. Lake was in Africa during an outbreak of the bubonic plague. And he was helping bury people. And the British doctors came in, and they came up on a frigate, medical frigate, the river, and they got in there, and they came in and said, Dr. Lott, you got to stay away from these people. You know, he said, why? He said, they're full of the plague. He said, when they would die, their lungs were so full of this junk, this froth, this discharge just drained out of their mouths. It was nasty. It was a horrible death. He said, okay, guys. He said, go take one of your Petri dishes or slides for your microscope. Go get some of that. And they did, and he said, look at it. He said, oh, yeah, it's got bubonic plague all in it. He said, fine. He took his hand and wiped some off and wiped it on a slide and said, now look at it. They put it in, and they said, it's dying. He said, yes, sirs, that's the law of the Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus, overcoming the law of sin and death. That's what's working in you this morning. There's a greater law in you than is in this world. That's why John wrote to the church and said, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Do not relegate yourself to your inability to fix it. I mean, your ability to fix it or inability to fix it. Do not cast yourself down into the place where you have to depend on you to get you out. Get like Paul and saying, Lord, I've reached the end, but glory to God, it's dancing time. Put you some Holy Ghost music, hallelujah. You know, when the Spirit of the Lord comes on me, I'll dance like David danced or whatever. You know, I mean, that's probably that little Tulsa two-step thing they do. Anyway, get after it. And just rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. And become independent of the circumstances that try to govern and control your life. And you'll see your human condition become a Holy Ghost condition. Paul wrote to the church at Rome in Romans chapter 6, verse 4, and it says that we've been brought to newness of life. J.B. Phillips says that we have been brought into a whole new plane altogether. I hadn't had a runner yet. Should have had at least three on some of this stuff. Amen? Paul said, he's brought us into newness of life. J.B. said, a whole new plane altogether. You used to live down here. What's down here? Governed by the flesh, governed by circumstances, governed by all the stuff that goes on around you. But God lifted you up. Hallelujah. And put you on another plane up here called the Holy Ghost plane, called the plane of victory, called the place where you overcome, called the place where you live above the fray, called the place that you live in the anointing, hallelujah, called the place you live in the presence of God, called the place where you look at the circumstances and say, you ain't got nothing on me. Jesus said that the enemy, the thief cometh, but he's got nothing on me. Hallelujah. Get caught up with the Lord and you say, the enemy comes, but he ain't got nothing on me. I now exist on a whole new plane altogether. What plane is that? The plane of victory. The plane where you live the life of faith and you live in victory regardless of what's going on around you. You don't look at those things. What happens when you begin to initiate that? When the things come to defeat you, and you don't look at the things which are seen, but the things which are unseen. The things which are unseen are eternal. The things which are seen are temporal. They're subject to change. When they come, you abide in the unchangeable, and it changes the changeable to match the unchangeable. But you got to stand your ground in faith. And you do that by getting your eyes up. Folks, Peter walked on water. And Peter walked to and from the boat on water. It was only during the middle of that he got his eyes off of the Lord and got him on the circumstances that he sank. Jesus did not drag Peter back to the boat. Save me, Jesus. No, that's not how it happened. They went back to the boat together. He got his eyes. You may have gotten your eyes off the Lord and you may begin to sink. He cried out to the Lord and they went back together. They walked back together on the water. It's time we start walking again on the water. It's time we stop sinking and start walking on the water. Can you say amen? Amen. Can you say Shunda? Now, what's that mean? Then you're not an old charismatic. All the old charismatics in the 70s, when they got filled with the Holy Ghost, said Shunda. Yeah, they did. Every charismatic I knew that I got filled with the Holy Ghost, they said Shunda. What does Shunda mean? Ask any old charismatic. They all have their own interpretation. Everybody had a definition for Shunda. Amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.